Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. I do have a couple of quick comments, a couple of quick thank yous. This sort of thing doesn't happen by itself. First off, you know, this isn't the health department. So I want to thank the folks at OSUM for hosting us today. We really appreciate the use of the facility. Dean Rose wasn't able to be here today, but I know I saw Gary a second ago, and there's Gary and Dave Playborn around. I saw him too. Anyway, so thank you guys for helping support that. I also want to thank Ohio Health Marion General Hospital for sponsoring our lunch today, which while we have it, I'm sure will be wonderful. And that'll be a little bit later, obviously. I want to give a special thank you to Marion Community Foundation, because that was really the funding that helped us realize that we could do something like this. And that funding was really what supported our bringing in a nationally recognized speaker to facilitate our meeting today. I also want to point out and recognize Teresa for her partnership in helping to conceive of this idea with the Y and the Pioneering Healthier Communities team. That was all a big piece of making this happen. Before I introduce our facilitator, I do want to invite up Mr. Joe Gilligan from Senator Sherrod Brown's office, because he has a couple of comments he wants to make to get us launched in the right direction today. So, come up and.
So yes, I'm Joe Gilligan. I'm Senator Sherrod Brown, Central Ohio Regional Director. Senator Brown couldn't be here today because he's scheduled to be in another part of the state, but he did want me to read a letter on his behalf. And before I do so, just want to kind of make a couple of acknowledgments. First to Mayor Schertzer, who worked for Senator Brown several years ago, and thank you for your leadership, Mayor, and for all that you do for Marion and the area, and to Tom, thank you for your leadership. You know, you've worked with Senator Brown in many different capacities along the way, and have been a great partner. And you know, Marion, is really in good hands with the leadership here. Marion, you know, should really take pride in the realization that your health department, should be counted not just among the state but the country's champions in public health, and that's because as we get around the region and state, Marion stacks hands as well as anybody, and that is sort of a testament. This room is a testament to that. Not everybody here is directly related to the public health realm, but there, those degrees of separation are critically important. It takes everybody to come together to improve everybody's situation. And a couple of years ago, Senator Brown was at a Martin Luther King Jr. breakfast, and a pastor said, your life expectancy is related to your zip code. And if you think about that for a second, it's startling, but it's true in certain areas in particular. And that's something that Senator Brown really thinks needs to change. And I think the work that you guys all do and the things you're going to discuss today will help kind of bend that curve in a very positive way. So thank you for your participation, and thank you for not just telling what you believe in, but showing what you believe in by being here today and for the work that you do every day. So I'm going to read a quick letter from Senator Brown, and then we'll get the program continued here. Dear friends, I would like to congratulate Marion County Public Health as you celebrate the Health and Equity in All Policies Conference. As a member of the U.S. Senate, I'm working to improve Ohioans' access to quality health care, and I commend you for your acknowledgement of the importance of health equity and public policy. Through your dedicated efforts, the participants of the conference will have lasting impacts not only in the city of Marion, but the entire state of Ohio. Again, congratulations on your conference, and I wish you all the best in the years to come. Sincerely, Chair Brown, United States Senator. Thank you very much.
Okay, and I am cognizant that we have a mixed crowd in the audience. The reason that we didn't have another senator here is this is like an election year, and so we're mindful of that. And I took off my glasses a couple minutes too soon. I want to introduce our facilitator today. Mr. Barbosa. Mr. Barbosa is the Associate Director for Training and Capacity Building at Health Resources in Action. His work is focused on expanding opportunities for community members and building equitable relationships between community members and institutions. He develops and provides training and technical assistance, leads and participates in local, state, and national planning initiatives. Mr. Barbosa has extensive expertise and experience facilitating community processes and has worked with political organizations, tenant councils, gangs, parents, youth, and community resident groups. I will tell you that I was joking with him earlier because the bio that he sent me started off with working with gangs, and I thought, well, that's probably not the lead that I want with this group here. So we started with the political organizations, standing councils, and so forth. Mr. Barbosa is a member of the Board of Trustees of the Cambridge Health Alliance, board member of the Cambridge Public Health Committee, board member of the Committee on Public and Community Health, member of the Board of Trustees of the Phillips Brooks House Association at Harvard University, the chairperson of Men of Color Health Task Force, and on the board of the Design Studio for Social Intervention. Past board affiliations include leadership team for the Peaceable Schools Institute at Lesley College, MBTA Community Advisory Board, and Cambridge Peace Commission. Mr. Barbosa has served as an adjunct instructor at the College of Public and Community Services of the University of Massachusetts Boston, helping to develop curriculum focused on community youth work. Mo Barbosa is a native of Cape Verde Islands who grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts. He has a Bachelor of Arts degree from Washington University in St. Louis, Missouri. I'm not going to take any more time. We're going to go ahead and get started. Mo, here you go.
Thank you, Tom. Of course, I was trying to cut him off at Mo Barbosa, that was funny. Thank you all for being here. I see that you've heard that I have some kind of communicable disease and decided to stay away. So I'm gonna use my Oprah moment to walk around a little bit, and I'll invite you to come join us in the front as well. I was thinking that I would use some of the force of the power that's associated at this table here to bring you forward, but I think we're going to let you stay where you are. Let's find out who's in the room a little bit. How many folks got up on the right side of the bed today? Okay. How many folks got up on the left side of the bed today? There's always a few. All right. Also want to hear a little bit about where folks are coming from. How many of you work in or for government? How many of you are in the private sector? How about the nonprofit sector? Any faith-based organizations? A few faith-based, right? All right. Anybody just inherited a bunch of wealth and just sit around all day? Any of those folks? That's how those folks know. Okay, good. We have a few. All right. Good. I was telling Tom that every time I come to the Columbus area, I grab a bunch of shirts and pack them, and then once I get to the hotel, there's always the yellow and blue shirt that I know not to wear, so I didn't do it. I made sure I checked myself when I got here this morning. But I did want to mention that some of you may have watched the NFL draft last night. Okay, so yeah, I think it's worthy of a clap. Let's give a round of applause. The woman at the hotel where I stayed last evening mentioned that perhaps they should move the draft to Ohio. Just saying. You had a good night. And probably a good day today. We're going to jump into a topic that I hold really dear and close to my heart, this idea that we really should be thinking about health and really health inequity in all the policies that we do and in the work that all the parts of our community are doing, because they deeply impact the life of our communities. And so we're going to start with just a little bit of an example, and then we'll move forward. All right. Anybody remember Hurricane Katrina? All right. About 10, 11 years ago now, Hurricane Katrina ended pretty much our idea that we were prepared to deal with anything. And it is a historic moment for this idea of being able to serve everyone equally, and for helping us to think about where are the failures in policy that contributed to what happened in that space. This is an iconic photo of folks pleading for help as the water was rising. I had the chance to go with a group of about 15 college students about 6 months after Hurricane Katrina to go do some rebuilding. And the devastation in Louisiana and Alabama was, we use lightly the word amazing, but in the real sense of the word, real sense of just, someone took an eraser and just took it right across that area. And doing some work there with communities, I had the chance to sleep in many church basements, so I know. I didn't know that there were church basements in the South, so now I know. I had the pleasure of working with carpenters from all over the country who would come and give 2 and 3 weeks of their time. So they were, from Kansas City and from Ohio and from Nashville. They would come and give 2 to 3 weeks to lead teams of volunteers to rebuild housing. And as we talked about what was going on there, it always came down to, so why were some places more affected than others? And how did some communities suffer through the same storm differently? And unfortunately, one of the lines of separation was around race. And so I'm going to ask you to consider this question. In terms of what happened after, which policy most aggravated the disparity between the circumstances of black and white New Orleans? Was it A, Plessy versus Ferguson, which is our separate but equal kind of services, post-World War II housing policies, or levee placement and land constraints? I'm going to ask you to have that conversation at your table. We'll give you about 2 or 3 minutes to come up with an answer, and I'll be looking for one answer per table. So take a moment there, make sure you talk to the folks who are at your table, and if you don't know who they are, this is a good moment to make sure that you do. Okay. So, Tom mentioned that this was a group of folks who I would have to really coerce to get talking. I can tell that that's not really the truth at all, Tom. First off, I know that a lot of tables said all of them, and I know that we all want to say all of them, and partly that that's actually true, that all of them had a really bad effect. But we did ask for the most aggravated the disparity between black and white New Orleans. So I'll ask for, just by show of hands, how many folks landed on A? Okay. All right. Again, we're voting by table. How many folks landed on B? Right. And how many folks landed on C? Okay, that should be the balance. Okay, great. All right. Our friends at NACHO, which is the, one of these long acronyms, but it's basically all the county health officials across the country to come together, put this work together, and it's on their website if you ever want to find it out. They have some really great resources. But it's actually B, the post-World War II housing policies. And I want to just point out that this is one of those, how many folks remember taking the SAT? This is one of those SAT questions, in a way. You did well on the SAT, right? All right, good stuff. Because the question itself tells you part of the answer in terms of, there being a black and a white New Orleans to begin with, that the housing policies really separated where one could live and where one couldn't live, and what the housing stock was in one space and what it was in a different space, and your ability to get a housing loan or any kind of resources to improve your housing condition or be able to buy outside of a certain space. But all of these policies have the effect of concentrating poverty and concentrating the people who had the least ability to bounce back from this storm and this natural occurrence and be able to heal themselves. I often use this example to help us to think about what are the policy implications on real lived lives. And this is where our health and equity in all policies helps us. We have a definition, so anybody who came and said, hey, I need to walk away knowing what this means. This is from the Institutes of Medicine, our National Academies of Sciences. And I'll let you all take a look at that definition, the paragraph at the top. I'm not fond of reading off of PowerPoint. Anybody ready to just storm out of the room because they can't believe that that's up there? No, okay, so we're in the right place. It's important that we look at the premise for this definition, that good health is fundamental for a strong economy and vibrant society, and that health outcomes are largely dependent on social determinants of health. I want to start with that first premise, that good health is fundamental for a strong economy and vibrant society. All right. Does anyone have an example of where a society didn't have good health and what the impact was on that society? Yes?
I taught diversity at Harvard. I would teach a unit on this, and there was a short documentary that we watched on HBO. In a 8-mile radius in the city of Cleveland, the life expectancy went from like 64 years old to like 90 years old. And what changed was the socioeconomic status in that 8-mile radius from poor to wealth.
Good example. Other folks, a society where good health wasn't in place and what the effect was on the economy. You can go into the history books. Yes, sir.
Obviously, when the Europeans came to the Americas and such, introduced smallpox and other diseases that the native societies weren't able to pay.
Absolutely. And many places where that happened. Also, when folks first went to South Carolina and dealt with malaria, who had never dealt with malaria, kind of worked in the opposite direction. Yeah. Other folks? There's some unfortunate examples right now where HIV/AIDS in sub-Saharan Africa is taking countries that are very rich in commodities and made them economies that can't sustain themselves. In the modern era, while our life expectancy has gone up across most of the world, some of these countries have seen their life expectancy go down as low as 48. Imagine if you work in a place or live in a country where their life expectancy is 48, where there are so few adults that you can't have thriving business because folks die out before that. So we have to make some investments in good health. Now, Tom, your health commissioner, is much more famous than I am. He doesn't know this. So just after we did our little planning, I get an email from our, one of these national organizations around public health, and they scour the country looking for people who are doing good work, and there's Tom Quaid. Yeah. There's a picture and a quote. So yeah, exactly, it's on these websites. So I was, of course, really intimidated coming here, and he and I talked about who would be in the room, and he undersold. And he said, yeah, we have some people from this area and from that area, and talked, and here we are with an amazing room and the right folks. So we're going to dive into that in a minute. But I want to look at the second premise also. This idea that health outcomes are largely dependent on social determinants of health, that the outcomes for individuals, your health outcome, is largely dependent on social determinants. And this is a very different way of thinking about our health outcomes. We're used to taking some personal responsibility. Did I have that donut? My hotel's across the parking lot from Steak and Shake. And yeah, and I called my wife at 10:30 and said, Steak and Shake is across the parking lot. And she said, have courage. And I said, I will not leave the hotel until Tom comes by in the morning. And I didn't. I'm seeking applause here. Affirmation. There's still this like 4-hour window after this workshop's over, but I have to work on it. We'll swing by. Okay, there you go. Gotta help me here, Tom. These social determinants of health are sometimes a fuzzy topic, and so we want to make sure that we dive into them today a little bit. All right. Our friends at the Centers for Disease Control have some wonderful definitions and some tools. This is their definition for social determinants of health. Social determinants of health are conditions in environments in which people live, learn, work, play, worship, and age that affect a wide range of health functioning, and quality of life outcomes and risks. And they have these five domains, and I think you have on your tables in front of you a worksheet that just kind of addresses these. On the front side are these five domains: economic stability, education, social and community context, health and healthcare, neighborhood and built environment, with some areas under each one. And on the back are just some deeper examples, things that might be a little bit more true to where you are. So I'm going to ask you to take a quick moment to look through this list of examples of social determinants. And if there are areas that you think Marion is struggling with, I want you to circle that. If there are areas that you think Marion is struggling with, because we want to get a sense of what are some of the things that are here on the ground as we take into account the policies that we want to address this afternoon. And this is not the moment to circle the entire page. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to limit yourself to like three. Three, I know. So this will be our top three. There are not right answers to this, and many of you are going to have the exact same three that someone else had in the room, and some of you are going to have three that no one even thought of, and there's probably somebody who added one at the bottom already. But I want to get a couple folks to give us what their top three were. Let's ask somebody from a faith-based organization. We'll start there. And perhaps somebody in blue from a faith-based organization. Maybe somebody in blue with glasses from a faith-based organization. You want to give us your top three, Pastor Jackie?
Transportation options, like the Mad Bus stops at 5. Socioeconomic conditions. And are we still working on
COVID? Okay. We've got some friends around, so maybe you can follow up with it.
Oh, exposure to crime, violence, and social disorder.
Okay. All right. Let's ask somebody, is there anyone here from the university? Anybody here from the university with a Ohio State University shirt on? Oh, no, that's okay, we'll go over here first. He was trying to duck us, so I'll go with you, sir. Okay. Kind of bigger cluster areas from the front side. All right. We'll take one person from the private sector, and maybe someone from the private sector that's not wearing a tie. No one? All of a sudden, no one wants to point that person out. Okay, somebody from the private sector that is wearing, oh, you got somebody, there you go. Do you want to just tell us where you're from as well?
I'm from Maryland.
Thank you.
I had two, but one was, obviously everyone's seen the experience of crime, violence, and social disorder. Another one was socioeconomic conditions. I still haven't really seen one that stands out for number three.
Thank you. And how about someone in either local or state government, someone who's working in or for government? Is there somebody, not the mayor, because I don't want to put him on the spot again.
But I will. Great. Someone not the mayor, but I, if you, okay, great. Because otherwise I would have him choose somebody. Next time, yes.
The exact same ones that Pastor Jackie had, transportation options, exposure to crime, violence, and social disorder, and socioeconomic conditions.
Okay, great. And I want one person that has three that have not been mentioned at all. Or two that have not been mentioned at all. That would take it again.
Okay, I've got the availability of resources to meet daily needs. Access to economic, educational, and job opportunities, and then exposure to crime and violence.
Okay, great. You have a couple?
Availability of resources to meet daily needs and social support.
Okay. And I think we have one in the paint in the back there, yes.
Mine have already been picked, but I believe the social norms and attitudes of our younger generation.
Okay, great. So we see some places where these things start coming together. We are going to come back to these in the presentation this afternoon as we look at what are some local policies that we might want to think about. This gives us a frame also for how these social determinants affect people's real lived lives. One of the ones I want to point out is around social cohesion, how we interact with each other, to what extent we do or do not, and what are the dynamics of that interaction. Do I talk to and know my neighbor? Does my neighbor know my children? Do my children know my neighbor's children? Have they ever been over to each other's homes? It's one of the questions that gets asked very often in communities that say that they have good social cohesion across class or race or any other kind of differences. Well, have you been to that person's house? Do you know them in a non kind of just collegial way? Have you sat down and broke bread with them? And to push us to grow a little bit. I'm going to keep going here. So it begs the question, where should we focus our work? We've got a bunch of these different areas. Really thinking about where the impacts are, where should we focus our work? Traditionally.
Thank you, sir. All right, traditionally we focused based on what called our attention. And unfortunately, what usually calls our attention is mortality. So we have on here a few examples. Infant mortality, we've talked about life expectancy and things like homicide that become what we focus on, okay? I don't know what the rate of homicide is in Marion County. And I'll tell you that it's probably not as important as many other factors. If you look at crime, I always look at aggravated assault, which is a much better predictor of what's going on than homicide. Even in a place that has a lot of homicides, it's the iceberg. It's always what's underneath. I had a doctor tell us that he's so good at what he does that he can mask the homicide rate. And I was like, what are you talking about? He said, we save so many more people now than we used to, that you don't have a sense of what's going on if you only look at who gets killed. You have to look at aggravated assault, you have to look at total shootings, and then get a sense of what's really there. And that floored me, because you know what? I really want him to be that good. But it also means we have to look at things we haven't always looked at. But if we're only focused here, we're usually missing what's going on. So we're going to go to the next one. This is disease and injury. This is where our healthcare folks usually are. Here's where we play a role. I'm on the board of a hospital system. I have too many conversations about the volume. And it's not how loud you are, but how many patients you are seeing in a given period. Anybody here in healthcare? A few folks, got a whole table back there. Okay, great. We're usually here because this is when we see people. They either have a communicable or a chronic disease, or there's some kind of injury. They come to us with a problem. And our solutions are very often about the problem that's being presented. But that doesn't really help us really address what's going on in communities. Public health has really focused on risk behaviors. Things like smoking or poor nutrition, lack of physical activity, violence comes up here again, alcohol and other drugs, sexual behaviors, things that are putting the population at risk. And for a long time, this was most of our work, was trying to change individuals' behavior. We did a lot of case management and direct services in these two spaces. But really, we have to even take a step back from here if we really want to affect the overall health of our community. We have to think about the living conditions and what's actually going on that is putting people at risk. What are the kinds of institutional powers in place that either create or exacerbate some of those living conditions, or can be allies in changing those living conditions? And then what are the underlying inequities that are in place that also play a thread through there? I like to use this slide to ask folks to think about, this is the policy environment in which we are playing. This is the policy environment, and it's the entire spectrum. It's the entire spectrum. So as we think about what policies you might be able to affect, think about policies that impact not only individual choices, but the conditions in which folks are living. And if you think about these first three boxes, this is the environment that folks are living in. This is where we can make choices that and changes that affect not just a few folks, but hundreds of thousands of folks. And I'm going to use one example to get us rolling. How many of you grew up wearing a seatbelt? Okay, there are like two or three really safe families or some folks that are a little bit younger. How many of you have ever ridden in the back where there was not a seat? Right? That was like the fun part. My dad had a Pinto wagon with the wood paneling, and we would ride in the back even when there were open seats. Because as children, we enjoyed bouncing around on the road. And you know, if you decided to do something like that now, I would probably stop you in the parking lot. Simply by putting seatbelts in place, we have saved hundreds of thousands of lives, some would even say millions. And not just from, you know, motor vehicle accidents where someone, you know, crashed into something or somebody crashed into you, but all those things that we used to call fun, like riding around in the back without a seatbelt, down a hill, over the bumps, into the field. Anybody ever swim in a quarry? Right? How many of you have your children swimming in the quarry now? Right. There's some fundamental changes that have been made in terms of what's allowable or even encouraged that have changed the safety of our children today. They will not believe that there was a time that cars did not have seatbelts. It's unbelievable to them. Unless you've ridden on a yellow school bus without the seatbelt. Yeah, they still have those. These are simple policies. As I was approaching my 18th year, the drinking age went from 18 to 21. I wasn't that interested in drinking, but I did want to be able to go into the places where people were drinking. Now, how many of you became 18 when the drinking age was still 18? Yeah, we're still jealous. We're still with y'all. Tom and I are not that far in age, but now I know he's one of them. That enjoyed that first 3 years of, I turned 21 my senior year of college, second semester. So much of that kind of enjoyment I didn't have access to, which I'm fine with. But that change in that policy, that change in the law, reduced the number of young people who were victims of drunk driving accidents by 83%. 83%. And there's, you know, the arguments for raising the drinking age were about lots of other things, but it had this one very specific effect. And that was one that's kind of undeniable now. I wouldn't go back and change the law today. And that's part of what we're thinking about, is that when we make these kinds of policy changes around health and equity, they become part of how you would live your life anyway. That you couldn't think of going back to no seatbelt. That you would never allow the laws to change to go back to drinking age of 18 or 16 or 14 or something. When I was younger, I went to Montreal. Anybody been to Montreal? You folks, good. All right. And as a 15, 16-year-old, I somehow looked old enough to do whatever, you know, whatever it was, walk into this bar or whatever. So I go in and I order a pizza because I'm 15. That's what I want there. And the guy is saying to me, well, don't you want something to drink? Coca-Cola. And he's like, well, you know, if you buy the pizza, it comes with a pitcher of beer. Coca-Cola. And trying to convince him to give me a pitcher of Coca-Cola, which at 15 was like, I'm sure just as good as a beer is to anybody who drinks now, was huge. And when I got it, I was very happy. But that was the environment that we were in. It encouraged a behavior that was risky to me. What we're trying to do is create environments that encourage the healthy behavior. So now we have a sense of where we should focus. We want to be thinking about policies that can affect folks across the board. What about equity? What about equity? This is one of those words that we hear bounce around, but we rarely get a chance to really think about and talk about. So I'm going to expose you to a graphic that pitches equality versus equity and the difference between the two. Dr. Thea James is a wonderful physician at Boston Medical, and she runs the Victims of Violence program that engages people once they've been shot into services to try to get them out of the environment that put them into that predicament. And she talks about equality versus equity in this really specific way. I had another graphic that's about a baseball game, but I like this one because it's about getting the apple. I think those are apples. What do y'all think? You go with me on apples yet? The difference between equality and equity is that we can provide the same for everyone, regardless of their need, or we can provide what folks need to get to the same outcome. That's the difference. And that if we really are thinking about equity, we have to think about what does it take for everyone to have the same opportunity for their greatest health outcome. And so this shorter individual here, we'll call him height challenged. He needs a little bit more to be able to get there. The folks in the middle, they need just one step up, and the taller person there, he was already there. He was already there. Now, one of the challenges to this is that it supposes that we are adding resources to the equation. That we are adding resources to the equation. One of our challenges may be that we don't have additional resources. There's not a, you know, millions and billions of dollars coming forward for public health anytime soon. Not gonna happen. It may mean that we have to think about how we are using our current resources and use them differently. about where the spaces where we might be able to support folks based on the need that they have and the distance that they have to travel, and make some choices about where those things happen. But if we're really serious about equity, we have to really be thinking about equity of health outcome, not just of what we provide. And in policy making, that means taking into account the distance between where people are now and where we're trying to get everyone to. And I'm gonna tell one of my secrets, I took a picture of this slide at a presentation. Microphones. So if you like this slide, I'll ask you to take a picture now. Feel free, and I'll bring it back. You also have it in your packet. You want me to pose in front of it?
Absolutely.
This is like the reverse of a selfie. And I'll actually get out of the way in case you actually want to use it. For those of you who are asking, there's no copyright infringement here or anything like that. The other thing you can do is just draw it yourself, and then it's yours. Is that all right, Judge? You think so? Okay, good, all right. We've had a ruling. Just want to make sure we're done with the photos. Another term that gets tossed around a lot is this idea of health disparities. I just want to give you like the framing for health disparities is the difference in the incidence and prevalence of health conditions and health status between groups based on race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation, gender, disabilities, just geographic location or combination of these. And I want to use geographic location to kind of get us thinking. The example that someone shared earlier about the difference in terms of zip code and where you live is prevalent across the country. And when they map for different things in communities, those same zip codes are the same ones that have prevalence of disease, low socioeconomic status, have a whole host of risks, have higher rates of all the bad things that you would want, have the least of all the good things that you would want. And it's almost predictable, which is part of the crime in all of this. But if we know that it's happening and this is where it's going to happen, then we should be doing something there. Part of thinking about health inequity in all policies is to think about where is it that the problem is happening and where is it that our policies can support making the change happen in that space. I'll use one example. Our friends in South Los Angeles, which doesn't always get a good reputation, they decided that there were too many liquor stores in their community. And that the effect of those liquor stores was that, of course, people were, we can say, addicted to alcohol. I think they use the term alcoholic. And that there were exposures to alcohol for young people because of the readily accessible and availability of alcohol almost everywhere. So just in the area of South Los Angeles, they closed 200 liquor stores. 200 liquor stores. And when they did that, they saw some good returns in terms of people's reported use of alcohol in the last 30 days and young people. But what they hadn't really counted on, or it wasn't really part of their projection, but that they were happy to report, was they also saw a 27% decrease in crime in the blocks around where those liquor stores used to be. And that part of what they were seeing was that folks who weren't so inebriated that they would do things bad in their community weren't doing them when the alcohol wasn't there in the same way that it was before. It was a policy that was around, not around crime and violence, that had a really beneficial impact on that area. And when they looked back and said, oh, that's why the police commissioner was at all those meetings, that was why. And that there was support from law enforcement community for the changes in the policies that allow them to close those 200 liquor stores. I live in a city that is 6.2 square miles. I know some of you are thinking, well, that's a little bit bigger than my backyard. 6.2 square miles. In 6.2 square miles, we have 5,000 liquor licenses. 5,000 liquor licenses. And I'm on the Board of Health, so I'm thinking to myself, this is impossible. That's like you walk every three blocks and hand a liquor license out. And the gentleman who's kind of the regulator for this, no, it's not that. It's almost every block that there's a place where you can get alcohol on just about every block. And it also means that we have residential parts of the community where there aren't any places to get alcohol, but that means that other blocks have six or eight places to get alcohol. And that includes restaurants and other venues, hotels, etc., bars, taverns, private clubs, etc. But it's 5,000 in 6.2 square blocks, 6.2 square miles. So sometimes the data can also give us some insight into what we can do about issues. I use that to say that these health disparities also don't come out of nowhere, that they visit our communities in the same way that we just talked about those social determinants of health. Some of you are wondering, who are all these people and why are they here? You're looking around the room and saying, wow, we've got all this amazing set of folks here. Who are they and why are they here? So I'm gonna ask you to have a quick conversation at your table. What are the policies or issues and populations that you care about, and why are you here today? And we're gonna ask the person at your table with the longest hair on their head to go first. Person at your table with the longest hair on their head to go first. Tables, thinking that they're going to be far away from the presenter, and I didn't want you to feel left out, so I came back here. Let's just get a few examples of folks. Tell us the policy issue or populations that you care about. Well, let's start with somebody in a green shirt. Anybody have a green shirt on? Oh, look right there. Purple shirt. Anybody have purple on? Purple. Purplish, lavender shirt. Yeah, why not?
Handball, right?
Handball.
So I'm from a healthcare perspective, and so we are looking to what community partners can we look at from a continuum of care, because we can treat the acute setting. It's just what's the follow-up afterwards, because that's, you know, government's high regulations as to what we are getting paid for. It's going to make a difference for how we can serve the community, etc.
And how about somebody in glasses? Anybody wearing glasses who would like to go next? And so you're going to make this easy for for me. A lot of folks starting to take their glasses off. I see you. All right.
Purple glasses.
Oh, purple glasses. Okay, let's do that.
Do they have to be on? Oh, okay. So why am I here? Because Tom asked me to. But additionally, I really care about my community. And I want to help feather partnerships where we can all work together, share our resources, so that Marion becomes, oh, I almost said a Donald Trump line, back up. So Marion can become great again. It really was.
Great, absolutely. We'll take a couple more. How about somebody from that table right there? We haven't heard from you all. Yes. Maybe somebody in a OSU shirt who ducked us last time. Yeah.
I took my glasses, but I mean, I'm actually from OSU as well as
really?
A pastor.
Here. OSU?
Yeah.
OSU. Oh, right there.
But a pastor here in the community, and my passion is more focused, or at least for being here, is focused toward information for the minority community. A lot of the information you're giving today obviously affects the African-American community as well. And the access to the African-American community, especially on Sundays, and all, I'm able to get the information out.
Thank you. And maybe somebody from this side of the room that we haven't heard from. And all of a sudden, like, folks are like, look, I've got two shoes. They're twins. Anybody from this side of the room? I know there's some folks who aren't that shy. Thank you, sir.
I'd say community development for me. So, again, a strong community future, but also student development as well. Readiness, job readiness, those kinds of things, mentorship.
All right, and speaking of student development, can we give a round of applause to our high school students that are doing the filming here? Good, that was my secret way of getting to the front again. You caught me, or the cameras did at least. So we come from lots of different places, we care about different populations and policies, but we're also here because we care about this community and want to do something to encourage folks to work together to help the community get better. I'm going to show you a slide that I think illustrates a lot of what we see. These community silos, this is our friend Tyler Norris, his name is right there. Just in the ways that many communities are siloed by all the different parts of it, like faith groups and clubs and police and municipal government, businesses, the arts, civic groups, economic development, all working along, doing some good work, but often working in silos and not finding ways to work together. Many of you are familiar with the idea of healthy communities, which is bringing together folks to work together on issues that make the community healthier. Not just address problems, but really thinking about how do we move to make our communities healthier. And that really takes having all of these folks involved in this space. So we're gonna do the quick hands up on this. How many folks here are in economic development? Hands up on economic development. Okay, at least one or two, okay, great. Civic groups, anybody involved in a civic group? Wonderful. Education, how many folks involved in education? Okay, some hands going there. Anybody in a neighborhood group? Maybe on your own time, a few folks there, yeah. Healthcare, I know we saw some healthcare folks before. I'm gonna give you a little bit of advice here. If you're raising your hand has to go over your head. So let's try that again. How about healthcare? All right, I'm a public health person, so that kind of movement is just part of keeping you healthy, okay? Or at least your right arm, okay? Faith groups, we did this before, hand over your head. Good, over your head, yes, all right. Transportation, anybody here involved in transportation at all? Again, hand overhead so that we can see it, okay, great. Some of you are hiding like the mayor's looking, okay. Folks in clubs, any private clubs or group clubs, okay, good, all right. Police, at least a couple there, good, all right. Any nonprofits or not-for-profit organizations, yeah, great. And housing, anybody working in housing or support housing, some folks there. And the arts, anybody involved in the arts? There you go. Some of you, your arms are getting tired. You're doing so much in this community. Municipal government. There's a few folks there. And last but not least, business. The private sector, we got some folks there. And obviously, many of you are working across these different silos, different places. What we're trying to do is create spaces where these silos no longer matter. And one of those ways is by making sure that when you're working on projects that you have people involved who perhaps don't see it as the main line of their business or what they do, and that you have a relationship with the people around the table before you need their help. Before you need their help. You know them, you've worked with them, and you've built some trust with them long before you need the police's support on an issue, or the private sector support on an issue, or healthcare support on an issue. You've been working together to make your community better in a way that it wouldn't make sense to not engage with this group of folks. I was in my neighborhood at a, we have elections pretty much every November, it seems. We had a series of candidates, so we're a small city, so we had 25 people running for 9 seats. And they almost outnumbered the audience in every one of these four, but in my community we had a lot of folks there. And one of the candidates got up and said, I've never been to a community forum where it was necessary to have the police there. And we all looked at him shocked, like, why would you have a community forum and not have the police be a part of it? They're not providing security, they're an invested member. And that's the difference that we're going to, is that the folks who are around the table are invested members of what we all do together. We use this multi-sector partnership wheel to just help us think about all the different folks who need to be involved, and also to remember that we need to engage and involve the kind of civic folks. So whether it's youth or seniors, parents, that they are resources to this community also. And I did want to just stop before we, actually we're going to take our break. We'll take our break because the microphone just stopped. And then when we come back, we're going to talk about which policies and give you some examples. Now, I do have some what we call homework for you during the break. The only thing I'm going to ask you to do is to give your chair a break also. So make sure you stand at some point during the break. All right? And we'll be back in about 5 to 10 minutes. Yep. Next to the people that you were sitting with, where you may have left some of your things. See if folks can quickly get back to their seats, yeah? All right. Okay. So, just by show of hands, how many folks said hello to somebody that they intended to say hello to during the break? Great. That's the networking that we want, and that's something that we want to make sure happens. Did anyone meet someone that they didn't know? Okay, all right, a few folks, wonderful. That's also something that's important here. And did someone catch up with somebody who they've been meaning to catch up with? Yeah, I live my life in the I've been meaning to catch up with you space. Great. Wonderful. We're going to get back into thinking about health and equity in all policies. Let's think about what kinds of policies are we talking about. So I'm going to give a few examples just to help us think about what this could look like. Our friends in Sweden, I know, Sweden sounds very close. Our friends in Sweden decided that they would like to get their fatalities from cars, people driving, and people on the roads, down to zero for the country. Now, when they took this on is because they saw that this was one of the, you know, greatest causes of people losing their lives in the country was to accidents, both people who were driving and people who were on the roads. Sweden is a lot like the Midwest. Towns, cities, and lots of space in between. And folks drive long distances to get to places. Now, I live in near Boston. An hour from near Boston is Maine. I went to school in the Midwest in St. Louis, and folks drive, they would drive to Indianapolis like you were going to the corner store. After class, we're going to Indianapolis. What? You're going to Indiana from Missouri after class to go get dinner. 5 hours, drop of a hat. Chicago was like taking a local bus. In fact, if anyone flew Southwest back then, anybody fly Southwest? Southwest back then had the plastic cards that you would get, like you'd get B-51, right? And if you didn't catch the 9 o'clock flight to Chicago from St. Louis, you just hang on to the card and catch the 10 o'clock or the 11 o'clock. And being a college student, I booked, you know, 8 a.m. and, you know, caught the 2 p.m. But I had that card, you know, I could go through it. Once you showed up at the airport, you can get it and then come back later. The idea was that this was close enough. Sweden was having this issue that so many folks were driving long distances and doing it at such high rates of speed that the roads that they were on were subject to many crashes and lots of fatalities. And so they decided to think about getting their road fatalities down to zero. And that took thinking about this idea in all the different policies that affect where people drive. And so it was reducing speed. It was thinking about how to make the roads that had different uses on them safer. So some traffic calming measures in the places where people were driving really fast. It meant that in more rural areas, they had to think about how does somebody cross this road where there's nothing. There's, you know, literally it's one field to the next. But people would cross the road because they were coming from this side of the forest to that side. There's lots of forests in Sweden. And they said, okay, well, what do we do here? Do we put a stoplight in the middle of nowhere? What do y'all think? No. Do we put some signage up that says people crossing? Because they have like moose crossing and those kinds of things. So, well, that's a great idea, right? What else do you think they might do to kind of create a crossing in the middle of nowhere?
Traffic circle.
Traffic circle, yeah. Why a traffic circle?
They're safer than intersections.
Safer than intersections. And also that you slow down to go into the circle and you have to look. And for somebody who's needing to cross, they can see where you're going and they see you slow down. So that's one idea. They also created some fairly natural ways for folks to have to look at what's on the side of the street. In the middle of nowhere, all of a sudden there were sidewalks. And on the sidewalk there was a bench. And next to the bench there was a sign. And so it gave a town-like feel to a otherwise empty space. And the people who were driving would slow down to just see what it was. And that meant somebody who needed to cross the street would have an opportunity to cross it. They thought about these policies in all the different spaces that they were in. They also noticed that, you know, if we reduce the speed that folks are driving down to the equivalent of 20 miles an hour, the crashes that they do have were less fatal. And so in the city areas, they reduced almost all of the speeds down to the equivalent of 20 miles per hour, which meant that, you know, people getting hit by a car as well as people in the cars were also safer and helped reduce the fatalities. It was taking this idea and asking how can you contribute to it in the sector that you are in. And so school children made signs of about safety and zero fatalities. High schools took on the challenge of creating a safe space around where the school crossings were. Local communities thought about how they promote some of the things that the national government was trying to do. Agencies and businesses thought about where they would be located that would make sense and help with this. It is about creating a vision for something and asking people to become a part of it. So that's one way of doing it. Our friends in Thailand, anybody know, anybody been to Thailand? Yeah, one. I think I could have said anywhere and Tom would have put his hand up because he's trying to support, be supportive in this moment. Thailand decided that, you know, one of the challenges that they were having with the knowledge economy was that as they were developing intellectual property rights, that they would run into situations where the health information of a specific drug or a specific interaction or a specific product was more important than the privacy for that organization. And they were struggling with what, how do we make this part of the disclosures that folks were doing or not doing at the time? And how do we ensure that when someone discovers something that's really beneficial to everyone, that it becomes part of what is available to everyone? And so as they were drafting their intellectual property rights laws, they put in there clauses that help keep information that's beneficial to everyone's health public. So your product would still be licensed, but any information that helped everyone would still be public. I thought that was pretty brilliant to think about. If you make a discovery, yes, you can make money on it, but we should also be informed by what it actually helps and how everyone can benefit from it. It's an example of thinking about the health of the community in a space where typically we don't think about health in terms of business. There are lots of local examples. So let's go at the state level. Our friends in California have probably done the most on this. So if you are looking for some good examples, there's wonderful examples in California. There's even a state local guide that basically talks about California in terms of this. One of the things that they did was to create a fleet of bicycles that were available to state employees. Okay, California's a really big place. Well, why would bicycles be helpful? Well, what they talked about was that very often they were going to a meeting at another agency in the same place, in Sacramento or San Francisco or LA, and driving back and forth not only, you know, added to the pollution, but also that you had parking issues and I know some of you all have seen traffic in Ohio. Anybody in traffic this morning? A couple folks? Okay, imagine that times like 200. That's regular Los Angeles. People plan on sitting in traffic for an hour and a half. And they said, you know, if we didn't drive or drive as often, we could actually make meetings that folks would come to and not be in a place that they, you know, had to be in a car forever. So they added that as one of the things in their transportation bill. They also added that if you were going to build new highway segments or off ramps, that you were also going to be responsible for things like sidewalks and trails and bike trails. Anybody have a bike trail near where they live? Everybody, right? Just about. We're getting to the place where there are bike trails almost everywhere. Now, one of the benefits of having a bike trail is you have a place to go and bike. How many of you have biked on the bike trail? All right. Tom, you pass. This is my secret question to see how many people are using them. It's one of those things like if you don't have the bike trails, then people don't use their bicycles on it. They either are in the street and more often than not, they don't use them. So they put the bike trails into the transportation bill. But if you're going to build the, you know, areas, if you're going to ask for some variances, you're going to also be responsible for making those spaces more available to different modes of transportation. Let's use some local examples of counties, cities, and towns. Our friends in Nashville, how many of y'all have been to Nashville? Okay, good, good, good. It's not that far away. In their transportation department, they decided to put health policies as part of the evaluation of any proposal. And so if you're making some proposal to do some of the work that their transportation department is meeting out, that health and equity are part of your proposal. You're going to answer some questions and describe how the impacts of what you're doing affect health positively. And folks in the beginning were skeptical about what this would mean, but it really meant that, you know, where are you encouraging people to walk? How do you encourage people to walk? Give them a sidewalk. So that's the big one. Okay. What else? Less parking. We're going to come back to that one. Yeah. What else? Shoes? Shoes, okay, yeah, absolutely. What else?
Opportunity to walk during the work day.
What else?
Give them a fun place to go.
Fun place to go, some destinations, yeah. What else?
Safe crossings when there are roads.
Yeah, so safe crossings, fun places. And it's not just less parking, it's where the parking is. So, is the parking in the garage? Is it near the shops? Is it in front of local restaurants? And what they found was that if you put the parking closer to where your destinations were, people went there more, which doesn't sound right. But by having the parking directly in front of the shops, people would stop, park, get out and walk, and they would walk to multiple places. Making it easier to walk is really around safety as well, and creating spaces that are a little bit safer to walk, and putting some of the crossings where you wouldn't expect them. So if I'm, how many of you have ever taught small children how to cross the street? Yep, so what do? Okay, first you tell them not to cross without looking, right? Okay, and then you say, look what? All right, so we've been doing this wrong forever. Looking both ways is great, right? If you're at an intersection, what does both ways mean? Is that enough?
No.
No, right? So an intersection is actually more dangerous to cross than the middle of the block. An intersection, you have to look the ways that folks are supposed to be coming, right? So that's one, two, right? Three, four. And for each of those, you also have to look at the people who are coming the wrong way, right? So you're expecting people to come this way, so you look at them this way and people coming that way, but you're not expecting someone in this lane to be coming also. So you're actually looking at, I think it's, and someone's gonna do the math for me, it's something like 16 different ways, right? If you're in the middle of the block, works really well. The problem is, where are our crosswalks? At the intersection, right? So one of the things that they did was to put the crosswalk in the middle of the block, on their longer blocks, obviously. And that also meant that cars knew that you were crossing in the middle of the block. They raised the crosswalk a little bit also. And so you could cross there a little bit safer. They looked at a lot of different things like road diets. I know some of you are like, a road diet? Someone want to tell us why that has nothing to do with food? Yes?
When you narrow the lanes to slow down the traffic.
So narrowing lanes, what else? That turn lane in the middle, so instead of having four lanes, you have three lanes. If you have that turn lane in the middle, that sometimes you can turn left or sometimes you can turn right, when I'm turning, I know I have to get into that lane. So now I've taken a four-lane street and made it three lanes. What does that add?
Space for sidewalks or bike lanes set off of the road.
Are you a transportation person? No. No? Wow. Doing it a little bit, kind of into it a little bit. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. Space for walking, biking, parking, all of those things. And it takes a little bit of rethinking a little bit of what streets might look like. But these are small changes that they were able and willing to do when they got folks in the room and showed them the different opportunities. So those are some examples for counties and cities. There are a lot more of these that we can think about, and we'll talk a little bit more about these as we go. Wanted to see if there are any questions so far. Any burning questions? Yeah?
There are those of us in this room that have to consider the cost.
What?
I'm just saying. Great ideas. I listen to a lot of these ideas all the time. I read them at YMCA. I love them, but there's a cost associated with all this.
Absolutely. I'm glad you brought up costs. I wasn't going to ask you to do it because that would be too much. But it's really important that we see the cost. And this is where, when you get folks together like this, we can ask the other question, what's the cost of not doing this? What's the cost of not doing this? How are we paying for the lack of health in our communities? So healthcare, loss of jobs, what else? People, you know, don't go here,
yeah.
Right? So there's a cost there. There's an opportunity cost as well. And we have to find solutions that will meet both the programmatic and policy goals without taking the price way out into the, you know, stratosphere. And so for Nashville, for example, they were in the middle of redoing parts of their main streets. And so part of the changes that they were making, it was between option A and option B, and option B wasn't so much more than option A. And that's part of how they made some of those decisions, is that, you know, what can we reasonably do within what we were going to pay for anyway? And how does what we do now impact our ability to retain commercial business and commercial businesses that want people walking in front of them? How do we get an ice cream shop in the middle of the block? It's got to be a couple shops next to it, and it's got to be people with children walking by. So how do we make that happen? What do we do to increase the level of foot traffic? All of those things were part of the conversations, but they were only part of the conversations because those folks were in the room. The folks who were developing the commercial blocks were in the room with the public health people, with the transportation folks, with the public agencies, with the public health and healthcare people, with faith-based communities. All of them were part of the conversation and pushing that these things would be important back in the places where they went to. Any other questions before we go? So I want to move us forward to really thinking about a framework for, okay, that's not it. There we go. A framework for health inequity in all policies. There are five key components, and we're going to spend a little bit of time with each of these, and then I'll give you an example, and then when we come back from lunch, we're going to dive into some policy examples from your local area and ask you to think about how you can use this framework to do that analysis. So we'll take each and one of these at a time. So promote health inequity and sustainability. What does that look like? So incorporate these into specific policies and programs and embed into government and organizational decision making. So if we really want to have folks using this health inequity lens, we've got to make sure that it's embedded into the places where decisions are going to be made. Whether that's in the processes within local government or within organizations or in the granting of contracts or embedding it in the process of evaluating those contracts. When folks were asked how will what you do impact health in the community? They then had an answer for the question. But if we're not asking the question, they're not considering the impact. And so one of the first steps is having that be part of the process and promoting that equity. So what is it that's actually happening in these communities, and how do we ensure that part of that is being thought about? The decision-making also can be in organizations. I think it's easy to point the finger at local government, but lots of organizations make policies that affect the health of communities. Anybody give an example of a non-government organization that makes decisions that impact the local community?
Tobacco-free work sites.
Tobacco-free work sites, okay. Tell us a little bit more. So offering a tobacco-free environment. So if you have 4,000 employees in a large building and that building goes tobacco-free, that's healthier for 4,000 people.
And
their families and everyone that goes, absolutely. And that doesn't mean you go, you know, kick all the smokers out. It means you provide them an opportunity to relieve themselves of that particular burden if that's something that they're willing and wanting to do. And maybe provide them a space where they can smoke without impacting the health of all the other folks around them. I remember walking through state agencies and people would be smoking at their desks. And you know, I couldn't, you know, as a public health person, I could not believe it. It was I couldn't have imagined this. I couldn't make it up. I would have never even thought about it. But that was just normal. And if some of you have been in some of our larger state agencies, it's a huge open deck. So if you're smoking at your desk, that smoke is going everywhere. And not to put smokers on the, you know, in the target, but important that as we impact other folks' health, that we have a responsibility for that as well. Other organizations that impact the community's health that are not government. Here's a clue, some of you are part of them. What do you think?
Hospitals.
Hospitals, yes, absolutely. Any aspect of healthcare, where it is, who it serves, what its hours are, and what those services are. Huge impacts on a community. I was in Northwest Ontario, and they had a helicopter service to bring women who were about to deliver from one community to the community where the hospital was that had a place for a birthing center. And I thought to myself, this is incredible. The part that was amazing was like, okay, they've thought about this, they've got a helicopter service, they're on call, you go into labor, and you know, instead of dialing 911, you call the helicopter and they come and pick you up and take you to the next community an hour away to deliver your baby. Of course, the other part of me said, why don't we have a birthing center here? Right? Kind of go back and forth. And they had some good ideas about, you know, centralizing those services so that the surrounding towns and communities could all come to one place and where it made sense. But they also talked about, like, we don't have enough births to pay for that in this town or city, actually. And until we do, then we're not gonna pay for that. And that makes sense too. But they had a plan for it. They understood what the disparity was. These people had a place to give birth in this place. These folks didn't, and they created a way to do that. The other ingenious way that they did was that this wasn't a dedicated helicopter service. This was the transportation mode that folks took anyway. It's Northwest Ontario, it's Canada, it's cold. The roads are pretty amazing, but there's these really large beasts on the road called trucks. I think some of you have seen them here too, yeah? And one of the things that they said is if you put an ambulance on a road in the snow with trucks, not a good idea. So the helicopter made sense, right? That was one decision that they decided that worked for their community. And think, as you're thinking about these policies, is what works in your community. We're going to come back to smoking in a little bit, but I want to make sure that I touch on all of these key elements first. Support intersectoral collaboration, bringing many sectors together, and deep and ongoing collaboration. So this can't be the only time that you see folks in this room. And if some of you are used to seeing a bunch of these folks at different tables, then you're doing it right. These should be lots of different tables with lots of you are seeing each other and working on lots of different things. That ongoing and deep collaboration allows you to create some of the things that will benefit the community broadly and ensure that the voices of all these different folks are engaged in it. We're going to talk about how that works next. So benefit multiple partners, co-benefits. So how long have any folks here been married more than 20 years? Wow. More than 20, keep your hands up. All right, more than 25, more than 30, more than 35.
To the same person?
There's always one. Sure, yes, to the same person. More than 35, more than 40. Okay, somebody's gonna win. More than 45? Okay, now somewhere in the 40 to 40. Oh, we've got one there. How long, sir? 52 years. Can we clap for that? So you're familiar with the idea of co-benefits? Yeah, absolutely. The young people have this idea for, I think it's like friends with benefits. I've heard of that. I'm into co-benefits. My wife, you know, we've been together good, almost the best of the last 20 years. And I say the best of the last 20 years because all the years with her are the best of those. I know you can use that though. I didn't copyright it. Feel free. You know, if you've got an anniversary coming up, yeah, absolutely. The co-benefits with her that she describes are things like dental insurance. And that I spent last night and the night before putting things together from IKEA. Or furniture moving, or taking out the trash. I, of course, describe the co-benefits as a male in that relationship as I will live 5 years longer because I'm married. That's a huge co-benefit to me. So any of you who are thinking about divorcing that guy in your life, it's like homicide. Don't do it. You don't hate him that much. Okay, you can work it out. 5 extra years. Now, I told her that she was giving me 5 extra years, and she, of course, said, well, you have to outlive me, so I don't know how you're going to do that. You're going to catch up somehow. Co-benefits in our community, meaning that as we're trying to balance health equity with other things, that there has to be ways in which we're getting to some, either some win-wins, or that we're addressing the policy and program goals at the same time. That if we want to improve the health of our communities, it has to go along with addressing some of the other things that we're trying to do. So if we're trying to increase the tax revenue in our community, we shouldn't be giving that up to make our community healthier. In fact, it doesn't actually work that way. It doesn't work to do that. If we're trying to increase the number of folks who have health insurance in our community, it doesn't mean that we want to increase the number of folks who don't have it first to then give it to them, right? No one would do it that way, right? You don't go and find a bunch of people who don't have health insurance, move them into your community, and then give them health insurance. That doesn't work, right? That seems ludicrous. So we want to make sure that as we're trying to develop these co-benefits, that there are some opportunities for win-wins. There are opportunities for some of what you're already trying to do to perhaps add a health component to it, or find ways in which people can ask the question, how will what we're doing affect health? Now, housing is one of the things that comes up very often, and we're going to use smoke-free housing as an opportunity. And so I want you to just start thinking about what might be some of the co-benefits of smoke-free housing. All right? We're going to come back to that in a moment. So, engaging stakeholders. I'm going to start at the bottom, private sector. These are people who care deeply about your community and very often are least engaged in the conversations about making your community better. They need an invitation and they need some relationships to bring them in. They already deeply care about your community. They have invested their business in the place where they are. Some of the leading proponents across the country of engaging high school students in their education are the folks who lead businesses. Especially if they lead some of the larger businesses, they're thinking about their workforce in the next 10, 15, 25 years. And why they're engaged is that they're desperate for better trained workforce. They need people who are going to be better ready to take on the work that their companies will be doing 20 to 25 years from now. Likewise, they're deeply invested in their communities being safe and being healthy. So engaging them might be sending an invitation, making a relationship, bringing them on board sooner. Funders, and I use funders for the like broad sense. Anybody here in philanthropy? A few folks, yeah. So lots of different kinds of philanthropy and lots of ways in which, you know, small amounts of money can catalyze big change, and lots of ways that big amounts of money can catalyze big change also. So I don't want the small money over big money conversation. We need both. All right. Important that funders are at the table because they also can spread ideas and spread the idea of collaboration. That that's something that they can ask folks to do. Advocates, the folks who are already involved in this, experts, the folks who know a little bit more about it, and then community members will outlast all of us. All of us. Anybody here know somebody who is 90 years old? Right? Wow, this is some long-lived Marion. I gotta move to Marion. This is wonderful. Or maybe it's the same 90-year-old that you all know. Is that what happened there? So everybody knows Grandma Moses, and she's same one? No? Okay, good. So different grandmas, good, that'll work. And by the way, it's always grandma. Very few granddads in the 90s. But important that if you know folks who are gonna be here for a long time, they've seen a lot of change. The things that they care about, the people who are going to be here 30 years from now care about, are the things that they will help to make happen. So if you engage community members, they can carry the torch when, Tom, I know, you've been called to the big show. They're gonna move you over to, we'll never let this happen, by the way. Tom's gonna go over to the state. No, right? Well, one day. But the people who he's been working with in community will hold dear the things that Tom has been working on. Now, that was a hypothetical. We're never going to let it happen.
Two board members in the room.
They're like, it won't happen. Absolutely. But you get the point that we may move on from the places that we are working in, but the people who are members of this community who live here, they will be here. And they can be really valuable resources to keeping the torch going after maybe we've moved on. It also ensures that we're actually being responsive to the needs that exist. So if there are communities that are experiencing disparities, you have to have them involved so that they can tell you whether or not what you're going to do is responsive to their needs. And then creating meaningful change and impact. The folks who are suffering the disparity, they're going to tell you that's just a Band-Aid. That if you're proposing something that's not going to be effective in making real change, they're going to tell you that that's not going to work. That's not enough. And we need to hear those messages because it would be really easy to do things that gloss over the problem. It'd be really easy to do sometimes include things that make it look like folks were heard, but don't actually change anything. But when those folks are in the room and they're part of the project that you're doing, they're going to insist that you actually meet the needs that you're talking about. So I'm talking about folks who are perhaps low socioeconomic status, folks who are currently unemployed or underemployed, folks who are transitioning from one area of the workforce to another, folks who are suffering in some kind of condition in your community that's based on the environment that they've been a part of. It's folks who are transitioning from, you know, one status of life to another. How many folks here know someone who's retired? Right? Do you look at them a little jealously sometimes? Right? So my dad retired about 10 years ago, and every conversation I have with him is, you know, how you doing, you taking care of yourself? Same thing, like, you know, be good to yourself. Since like 12, he's been saying the same thing. But sooner or later, he gets around to what he did that day, and it's typically like, yep, I went there. He lives in a little fishing village on an island in West Africa. And so the water is 150 meters away. He walks down to the water at about 5 of 11. The little fishing boats come in. It's like, you know, the rowboats. These aren't like big fishing trawlers or something. And he picks the fish that he wants. The guy cleans it on the rocks right there. He puts it in the plastic bag, same plastic bag every day. Brings it 150 feet, or it's probably feet, not meters, back to the house. Hands it over to my mom, who seasons it. He grills it. They toss together a little salad, and they call it lunch. And so I, who am very far away from retirement, am very, very jealous. But the other thing that he has is the time to take on issues that matter to him. So one of the things that he cares about was the amount of lead content in the toys that kids were playing with. And so he ordered, somehow he can get Amazon to deliver things to my house in Boston that then I sent to him. So he ordered some equipment to test the lead in the toys that people had that I sent to him. And now that's something that he's taking on in his local community. In your community are thousands of retired folks who care deeply about your health and the health of their children and their grandchildren. And they are a resource. There are thousands of young people, like our friends in the back of the room, who care about this community and want to be able to live here one day. And there are thousands of other folks in between who are willing to take part in making the community better. The last key element is this idea of creating structural processes, changes. So institutionalizing across the whole of government, so not just in one place or one agency, but across the board, this idea that health and equity should be part of what you're doing. And then permanent change in how government organizations make decisions and how those agencies relate to each other. That's the space that we want to get to. So I'm going to use smoke-free housing as the example. Anybody not familiar with smoke-free housing? Okay, good. Anybody familiar with smoke-free housing? Awesome, we've got a few folks. The idea here is that if you're going to build new housing, that you would make it smoke-free. Okay? If you're going to rehab public housing or subsidized housing, that you would make it smoke-free. And can you encourage private builders, developers, to create housing that's also smoke-free if they're going to build not one house, but if they're building buildings that have multiple residences attached to one another. So the idea there is that if you're going to create these spaces where people live next to each other, that one person smoking won't have deleterious effects on the health of other people around them. And so a simple policy that says that if you're going to, you know, create these spaces, they have to be smoke-free, creates a better health environment for everyone that's in that building. So if you're building a unit, a building that has 16 units together, for example, By making them smoke-free, you've improved the health of probably 60, 80 people just by doing that. And if you're building units upon units, like a place that has hundreds of units or a set of communities, you're improving the health of all of those folks around them, and it's both folks mentioned and their families. It seems like a really small challenge. There are a lot of folks who said, okay, well, I don't want to impinge on the people who are going to live there, or if I build it, if I make it smoke-free, no one will want to live there. Guess what? That's not true either. Not only do they get folks who want to live there, they are oversubscribed. And when you do this in public housing, you're also helping with the health effects of the people who are oftentimes experiencing the worst health outcomes. So you're getting to some of that inequity that we're talking about is by creating the space for healthy behaviors there. Now, one of the other things that folks have done right around smoke-free housing is, well, let's create spaces. If we're thinking about the health of the folks who are there, what other considerations might we take into making that space a healthier space? So,
green space.
Green space, yeah. So parks, or what we call pocket parks. Just a little pocket park, a little place there where you might sit down and read a book. Or on your way to walking to the store, you can stop there, rest, and then walk again. Now, some of you haven't, you know, don't have that experience because you're walking really fast to the store. I walked with my friend's grandmother to the store. And yeah, just the idea that there was a place where there was a bench made walking to the store not just enjoyable, but possible for her. That there was going to be a place where halfway she could stop, sit for a little bit, and then get up and walk the rest of the way to the store. Now, once we got in the store, she was like Energizer Bunny, boom, 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 everywhere. And then on the way back, we stopped at the park again. Sat down for about 5 minutes, just enough to catch her breath, feel, you know, rested, and then walk back to her house. Something really simple that improved not only the health, but the possibility of her going to the store, of her walking to the store. And of course, her doctor's very happy because she's walking. I'm, you know, ecstatic because she bakes. Did I mention that out loud? Yeah. So I have an ulterior motive, obviously, I'm being clear here. But those are small things that we can do. We can include in what we're doing opportunities to increase people's health. I'm gonna just finish off before we go to lunch on this idea of the structural and process changes, and then we'll move forward. Some of this is about what do we create that's really durable. So one of the ways to embed and institutionalize the health in all policies is having it be part of how a bill gets analyzed. So if you're in government, is there a screen for health inequity in that bill? If you're making a change to a budget proposal, or if you're making changes in a budget, how does it impact health and equity? Now, these are things that already exist that you're doing this with. State guidance documents. So if there's some guidance on how you're supposed to do something, does it take a health and equity lens? Is it included in there? Grant guidelines. Part of my work is in youth development, so ensuring that organizations are actually getting to the outcomes that they propose for young people. And I was shocked that at the state level, there were no guidelines about youth development in a bunch of the money that was being given out. So just including them in there helped organizations be accountable for those outcomes. Contracts across the board. Is there an opportunity to include health and equity in contracts? Strategic planning. How many of you have been part of a strategic planning process recently? Yeah. Any of you part of the local community health improvement plan? A couple of folks. All right. Including health and equity in those spaces can be really powerful because you're laying out for the next 5 years for your organization or your agency or for this community, what is it that you're going to work on? Last but not least, this idea of, okay, that's supposed to say program review. I'm not sure what a RevQ is. Is that an Ohio term? Program review and evaluation. So as you're reviewing what's been proposed, is there a health inequities in there? Are there things that we are looking at or for? So I'm going to give you another example just to help us think about this. What's the big supermarket chain in this area? Kroger's. Okay. And what's the other one that starts with an M?
Meijer,
right? So those are the two big ones. How many of them are in Marion County? Two Kroger's and one Meijer. So we've got three of them, right? And a Walmart that has food, yep, so that's four. Aldi's, five. Community Market, that's another one, okay. Six. Save-A-Lot, is food also? Okay, we're gonna go, that's seven, what else? The folks in the back are looking at me like, that's a TUMO, that's not seven. We're adding. GFS, is that a supermarket? But you can get food there, kind of like a supermarket? Three, okay, so we're at eight, all right. Dollar stores, they sell food also?
Yes.
Produce, okay, we're not gonna count CVS. All right, so we're on two hands, basically, all right? Where are those supermarkets in relation to this? The neighborhoods that are higher wealth and the neighborhoods that are lower wealth. Where are they?
Higher wealth.
Except for Community Market.
Except for Community Market because it's called Community Market. All right, and it's the highest. So I'm not telling you something you don't know already, all right? Supermarkets follow two things. One, there has to be enough there have to be enough people in a geographic area for them to be sited there. So you have to physically have it, something like 7,000 or something like that is a wonderful term that they use in the industry. And then two, they have to actually be people who will go and shop at that supermarket. They have to have enough funds to actually go and shop at the supermarket. So if you're a supermarket and you're trying to decide where should I be, I want to go to the place where there's lots of people and lots of people who have dollars to spend there or access to it. And this is the last piece that is probably the most important for a county like this. It's also about access. Can people get there? Right? Do any of those supermarkets have a bus stop near them? They're like a bus stop, what's that? All right, so that's one really simple way is if you have any kind of transportation, does it stop at the supermarket? Okay, so that's a good one, that's an easy one, right? So I'm gonna drop down from supermarkets. This happens in every community, the places where there's more money have more supermarkets. How about fast food places? Now, I told you that I don't know if Steak and Shake counts.
Yes.
Does it? You think so? Okay. But what kind of fast food do y'all have out here? Everything? Okay, you've got like Arby's? Okay. Do you have a Waffle House? No, okay. We don't have a Waffle House in the Northeast at all. So whenever I go to like Atlanta, I try to schedule a meeting at the Waffle House. And you'll be surprised how many local public health people show up to the meeting at the Waffle House. So I'm kind of like, this doesn't work, but it works. So you have McDonald's, Burger King, Wendy's, all of that, yeah. Chick-fil-A, all that. Checkers,
no.
Sonic, electronic, yeah, I have a bunch of those, okay? Where are those located in respect to low wealth, high wealth neighborhoods?
Scattered.
Oh, this almost equity, like they're equal. Yeah. I'm going to go out on a limb with you that in your city, it's probably pretty well spread out. And in the county, it might look a little different. Right? In your city, it's probably pretty even. But when you go out to the county neighborhoods that have a little bit more money, have a few less takeout places, neighborhoods that have, or parts of the area where there are less wealth, there are a few more of those. So that kind of evens out a little bit over time. That's pretty much the same picture everywhere that you go, is that the takeout places, the fast foods, are urbanly distributed well, and then outside of the urban area, it's only really where there's low wealth neighborhoods. And a lot of the high wealth neighborhoods have no fast food locations at all. The third one, which is the other one where there's a little bit more disparity, I want to make sure that I say this right. Different parts of the country, they call these things something different. I believe you call them bars here. Is that true? It's called a bar. It's not a pub or a tavern or a lounge. Lounges kind of come in and out. So bars, right? What about bars? If I said to you, where are those located in that low wealth, high wealth? Where are they? Besides downtown Marion. That's it?
West End.
Okay. West End. All right. We've seen a resurgence of restaurants that have bars as a big part of who they are as an identity. So a lot of those are in the downtown areas or the restaurant areas that you're trying to attract people to. But I'm also asking about like the local bar. The bar that, you know, doesn't have the big lights up front, doesn't have tables outside, doesn't attract just the college students. Where are those? Downtown, and I would venture if you go and look, a lot of them are in your low wealth neighborhoods as well. The disparity there usually is something like 2-to-1 to 3-to-1. That you'll walk in a neighborhood and it'll be, you know, Nick's Bar. And Nick's Bar, it still has the Schlitz sign from like 1972. That was Schlitz. Anybody know what Schlitz is? Okay, good. There's a few of you. Okay, all right. If I said MD, you would know what that is too? Okay, a few folks, okay. There's a distribution of those kinds of things in our environment that is very different than what we talked about fast foods and even about the supermarkets. That's the environment that we're trying to address. So how do we make the healthy behavior, the behavior that folks are encouraged to do, and the easier behavior? One way is to ensure that the supermarkets are close to the people who have the least access to healthy foods. So whether it's your seniors or people who are low socioeconomic status, that you can locate supermarkets near to where they are or other venues for fresh foods. And then reducing the exposure to fast food. So one municipality decided that you couldn't have a fast food place within 1,000 feet of their schools. And you know, I thought that was pretty brilliant because as a young person myself, years and years and years and years ago, I know that one of the things that I enjoyed in the morning was there was a bakery that you could go and like get like one warm roll or bulky bread or something, I forget what it was called, but for like 10 cents. And so we would catch the bus and then be a bus stop full of high school kids eating pieces of bread. Had that been a McDonald's, we would have had McDonald's. Had that been a, you know, ours, and nothing against McDonald's, in fact, I'm a McDonald's person, I love McDonald's, me and the fries go way back. But simply what was accessible and cheap was what we were doing and what was available. And so we can create environments where people make healthier decisions. Our healthy decision right now is that we are going to stop and lunch is ready and available. I'm going to let Tom give us some leadership on lunch. When we come back, we're going to dive into some local policies. Thank you. All right. So folks are back from lunch, and I'm going to ask you to do a couple things with me first to make sure that we're ready to move forward. The first, I'm going to ask you to stand up. I know. Yeah. You give a public health person a microphone, and what do you think is going to happen? Yeah? All right. Uh-huh. Okay, just making sure that folks, and obviously if this is a challenge for you to stand up, please don't. But if you can, I want you to stand up. All right. I need you to pull a little bit away from the table that you're a part of so that you have enough space to move. All right. Enough space to move. Okay. All right, folks pulled away a little bit there, okay. Let's make sure that you are within arm's length distance of someone next to you. So just spread your arms out there like that. Make sure that you've got a little bit of space. Yeah, yeah, and a little space there, we're good, all right, yeah. Okay, so we're gonna try to play a little follow game, okay? A little follow game, and we'll see how well we do. I hear that folks in Ohio are really good at this, so I'm gonna make it hard right from the beginning. In other places like New York or Alabama, I start really slow, so here I'm gonna go fast, all right? So we're gonna start by taking our right hand and putting it to the back of your head, okay? So I did that with my left. Did anybody else do it with their left? Okay, no, all the elbows are pointing this way. Okay, good, all right. All right, now I'm gonna ask you to lift up your right foot. Okay, all right. Make sure you're standing up still, okay? And if you're finding yourself leaning or if this is difficult to maintain, go ahead and put it down. Everybody put it down, everybody put it down. Okay, there you go. Now we're gonna switch right hand to the back of the head. Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, it's your right hand, I'm doing it with the other one. I know. Ah, follow game, yes. So right hand to the back of your head, you should be pointing this way. All right, and now we're gonna lift up our right foot. How do we do with that? Okay, all right, put it down. We don't want anyone to fall. All right, now we're gonna do this in rapid succession. Right hand to the back of head. Left foot up, left foot down, right foot up. Right foot down, left foot up, right foot down. Aha! You were already with your right foot down. Left foot down, right foot up, right foot down. All right, now put your right foot, right hand down, all right? I want you to turn to the person closest to you and thank them for sharing the space with you, and then have a seat. That was an example of an activity that you use your brain and your body for. So after lunch, it's important to do something that gets the blood flowing in your body, but also gets it going back to your brain. All right, so just really simple there. We were going to ask you to think about some local policies. So first thing I'm going to ask you to do is to go back to that sheet that had the social determinants of health where you did some circling. Looks like this. Great. And just take a look at what you circled before, because these are the areas that you thought were important. I think we said these were your top three. And then what I'd like you to do is to think about on this scale here, on the right side, or this is actually your left, living conditions, institutional power, social inequities. I want you to think about, for whatever your top social determinant of health, what's a policy that affects that social determinant, and then in which of these three boxes does it fit? What's a policy that affects that social determinant of health, and then in which of those boxes does it fit? And if anyone has one right off the bat, we'll just take a few examples. So you know which your, you've got one there, yes?
Oh, shared use policies.
Shared use of?
Of like schools or maybe other public facilities to be used for recreation purposes or physical activity or community purposes.
Yeah, which one of these boxes do you think that one goes in?
Institutional power.
Yeah, absolutely. One of our, in Boston, one of our previous chiefs of human services declared all of the public schools open for business after school. And so that at all of those schools, there would be an opportunity to base programs for young people, programs for adults, programs for seniors, programs that were academically focused, programs that were about shopping, whatever it was, there was a place for those things to happen. She then fought with the school department for a long time. A lot of things were thus cited. Other folks, other examples. Anybody have a gray or graying beard that would like to talk next? Anybody have a graying beard? I've got one, but you know, I'm already talking, so. Is there someone else? I've been told that this helps me to look distinguished. I'm not sure yet.
I'm giving an example of something that only applies to
males. No, I'm just trying to get a male voice since we just have a female voice. But good, you caught me though, you caught me. Any other folks have an example of one of these social determinants? Yes?
Transportation options is certainly an example, and in Marion, probably one that has come up quite a bit and could fit into, you know, several blocks, but I would put it into really that, those living conditions.
Yeah, absolutely.
And those policies can greatly impact that.
Yeah. So let me take one more. Someone is hiding behind their cup of coffee there? No?
No, I'm freezing.
You're freezing.
And it's keeping you warm?
Okay, good. All right. I was wondering. How about one more person? Yes, ma'am.
Socioeconomic conditions.
Okay.
Poverty, stressful conditions at
the hospital. Okay, great. And which of these boxes would you put that one in? Good.
Living conditions.
Living conditions, yeah, absolutely. So, what's the policy that affects that? Think about now, folks have been really good about choosing the social determinant and figuring out which one of those boxes it goes into. What's a policy that affects that? Yes, sir.
Well, what she was talking about, I think living conditions, I think a policy is you allow substandard housing continue to exist to sort of attract people who will, that's the housing that they live in, to concentrate the poverty. So you do something about housing codes, you do something about standards for construction.
So housing codes, construction standards, yep.
And the topic that you mentioned earlier about access to food,
yeah,
and that sort of thing.
Okay. We're building a little momentum here. So in the span of about 30 seconds, we've said that we want a house that's near, that's well built, that is up to code, that promotes people being there, living there healthy, being near healthy foods. Someone's going to say perhaps near transportation. I'm looking at you right there. Yeah. All right. Lo and behold, we've come up with a policy agenda around health for housing in 30 seconds. Maybe a little more, 35 seconds, we'll give it that, all right? What I'm gonna be asking you to do at your table is to take one of these examples, one of these social determinants of health, and think about a policy that you that affects that social determinant that you could make some changes to that would improve the conditions for the health of all people in your community. And especially if that social determinant is inequitably affecting a part of your community. Think about what are some policy changes that would affect the health of everyone in your community, especially those folks who are maybe suffering the inequity. And I know this is difficult to everybody at a table to choose one, so I'm gonna make it easier to choose one, okay? All right. So some of you have in the past, in some point in your life, maybe done a serious decision-making tool called rocks, paper, scissors. Yes, rocks, paper, scissors, yes. For those of you who are uninitiated, and perhaps for maybe some of our high school students who haven't seen this before, that's a rock. It is covered by a piece of paper that in turn is cut by a scissor, and that scissor is smashed by the rock, all right? This was the intention of our original framers of the Constitution. I'll let you decide which one is the presidency. I'm looking at the judge who's saying, I know which one is the judiciary. So I'm gonna ask you at your table to do rock, paper, scissors, and the winner overall chooses the social determinant of health. Uh-huh. So go with your table, rock, paper, scissors. And you gotta keep going until you get one winner. Things like that, and also for their children and what they suffer through. On the other end are also whether or not folks are participating in the prevention activities that are in place. And are there ways in which we can ensure that they're getting prevention care up front so that we don't have to see them at the other end? So are there barriers to access to preventive care, to healthy opportunities based on immigration status? And that's something to ask yourselves, are these things that need to be in place? And do we suffer because we put them in place? During H1N1, remember H1N1? It's one of those like mosquito-borne things that we freak out about every like 3 to 4 years now, something like that. One of the things that we had to encourage folks to do is that if you are coming in for a vaccination, we weren't going to check who you are. In fact, we were like, we did it in our health department, and afterwards we noticed that we had about 40% of the people weren't from our town or our city. But that didn't matter because what we wanted was for people to get vaccinated. And so are there barriers there that are around immigration status? That can have a huge impact on workplaces. My favorite one is gender. Are there policies that encourage bad health outcomes across your community based on gender? Anybody think of something that would impact gender health outcomes?
Planned Parenthood.
So that Planned Parenthood, okay, then folks there. What else? So wage inequities, certainly, okay. What else? Any policies that are broader that would impact gender outcomes, gender health outcomes?
Unsafe areas.
Say that again?
Unsafe areas.
Absolutely, thank you. So the perception of safety, something as a large African-American man I kind of don't even think twice about, is a huge barrier to people being physically active. I did a focus group with mostly people in their 60s, and we're talking about barriers to health. And this older man gets up and he says, you know, I'm 68. My doctor wants me to walk 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the late afternoon after the sun has started to go down. And he said, I'd love to walk 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the afternoon, but when I walk out of my door, I don't feel safe. So here is that community exposure to violence and crime having a really awful effect on this individual's health outcomes because he doesn't feel safe to take the 30-minute walk that his doctor is prescribing him for his health. My father had a double bypass a few years ago, and he takes like what seems like an hour and a half walk every morning. And he's up before, you know, 5 or something. By 6 o'clock, he's out the door. Before 7:30, he's back having walked 3 miles or, you know, something ridiculous like that. Those of us who don't walk a lot, that seems ridiculous. Some of you are like, I walk that all the time. Now, he will tell me that in his, you know, youth, he would walk 20 miles in both directions uphill. You've heard that story before. In the snow in Africa. I'm like, no. Something's not right about that story. I think it's the uphill part. But here was a man who was unable to do what his doctor was prescribing that would help his health outcomes because of the environment that he was in. All right? The exposure to violence. For women, oftentimes, the perception of safety determines where people are willing to go, even in their cars. What time of day they're willing to go places and what they're willing to do in those spaces. So are there safe, active places that everyone can enjoy equally? In younger days, I played basketball. Tom and I were talking about our respective athletic aspirations in our youth. I told him a few years ago I gave up on going to the NFL, long after the NFL gave up on me, clearly. And for those of you who are wondering, I was never going to go to the NFL. It just wasn't going to happen. But it meant that I have to have other options. And I feel like I have a lot of options. A lot of folks don't feel like they have a lot of options for healthy activity. They don't feel like they have a lot of options for where they can go. What else? Other policies around gender health outcomes. How many of you have had a physical in the last year? All right, it's a healthy group there, all right. All right, how many of you have seen your doctor more than once in the last year? And if we keep going with this, what we end up with is there's a gender who sees a doctor, nurse, or medical practitioner at one level, and there's a gender that sees a doctor, nurse, medical practitioner at a different level, unless something's going wrong. And what happens is that we have policies that reward people for not going to see their medical professionals. What policies are those?
Money.
What policy is it though? What do you think? Your health insurance. Yeah, co-pays. Lots of reasons folks don't go see their doctor or don't follow up is they don't want to pay the $30 again for their co-pay, or they have a high deductible, or they're uninsured to begin with. So there are policy opportunities that encourage people to see their healthcare professionals. Some of them are simple prevention visits. A well visit, for example, is a either low or no cost visit that you go and see, not when something's wrong, but in advance of things going wrong. And so encouraging people to do that. Some employers have encouraged their staff to get a physical every year, all their employees. And one of the ways that they did that was to have a weigh-in program. And most folks have that moment of like, you're gonna weigh me at work with other people? And that sense of fright came over them. But they got to go in and be weighed individually and no one had to see what they were. But what it said to the employer was, what is the BMI for my entire workforce? Folks familiar with BMI? Body mass index, good. And then what can I do if the BMI for my entire workforce is obese or overweight? What can I do to encourage my entire workforce to get healthier? Lots of things, right? So one of the things that they did was, you know, the cafeteria, these are big, giant employers, they changed what was available at lunch for you to have. Reducing calorie counts and reducing access to sugar-laden beverages, like my Coca-Cola that's right over there. So I'm thinking that I can go 24 hours without drinking it. I'm at 16. I need your encouragement. You can create policies that encourage the healthy behavior, so employers are doing that. Last but not least is sexual orientation. Non-discrimination policies make folks make healthier choices about where they work and the spaces that they're in. Making sure that we're creating spaces that are accepting also allow people to make better health choices. I wanted to, before we close out, to ask folks to think a little bit about the service environment as the other space. So we do pretty well thinking about like where people work, where people live, the kinds of connections between folks and kind of the labor spaces and the workspaces, but we don't think about the service environment, so where people go for services and where they receive services. Something as simple as, can I take the bus to the hospital? Yes? What do y'all think?
Yeah.
Depends on what time of day. So on certain days, at certain times, we can, and other days, other times, you can't. Hopefully, if it's an emergency, you can find another way to get there. That's one thing. Where are our other services? So where is, let's say, where's City Hall?
Downtown.
Can I get to downtown?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so that's a good one. What other city services or local services are in a place where perhaps aren't as accessible?
Our YMCA.
Where is your YMCA?
The edge of town.
Outskirts of the suburb.
Okay, all right. So for now, it might be difficult to get there. So are there solutions to where folks could go? Now, I, of course, am going to go out there, and we're not going to be able to move them. Not right now, right? But are there things that either bring the Y to you, or are there things that bring you to the Y? So your solutions might be around creating access points to what the Y offers and creating points to access the Y services throughout the city.
And provide this location we just did, by downtown,
Yeah, I don't recall seeing you at that activity.
I was promoting it from my desk.
He tweeted about it.
But I got tired of it.
Finger cramp, you know, it's tough. Are there ways to bring those services to the people where they are? Are there other services that can be sited closer to where the populations that need them are? So you have, you know, we talked about a food desert, so you've got a place where you could bring a farmer's market. You have farmer's markets, yes? This coming Thursday, May 5th, at what time?
The ones in here will be on Sunday, but there's another one downtown.
Downtown on Thursday, and the one here is on Sunday.
Every week at the rec center. Starting June 9th, every Thursday, right, downtown.
So I know one of the things to promote use of a local farmer's markets that we did in the city where I live was to make a weekly calendar of where each one was and what time it ran, and putting that in the hands of everyone who lived in areas where they will experience any food insecurity. And then what were the transportation linkages to those spaces? And one of the things that we also did was to do a winter farmer's market indoors. And we got one of our local nonprofits to house it. And so on Saturdays in the wintertime, you can go to the winter farmer's market. And in the winter farmer's market are fresh fruits and vegetables that are locally grown. Now some of you are like, okay, how does that work? All right, now I'm a city kid completely. No driver's license, never had a permit. You know, if I stick my hand in the dirt, it's by accident. So I can't tell you how they grow things in the winter. I can tell you that there are vegetables and fruits that are available in the winter time that I didn't expect. I can tell you that I've had all different kinds of squashes and pumpkins and root vegetables from that market that were available in the middle of winter. And that there are hothouses that grow tomatoes, I hear,
yes,
that are fresh in the wintertime, and other fruits and other vegetables. You've got a hand here.
Because I hear about all the opportunities, but are there barriers that people may experience to enjoy these? Like they have to provide a proof of address, they have to. Are you low income? Are there barriers that may prevent people from taking advantage of these particular things? I'm just asking.
So,
not really.
Any barriers?
Honestly, not really. For the ones that we run, they're sponsored through Mid-Ohio Food Bank, and it's you don't have to bring proof. I mean, it is an honor system, but they're basically looking more for the statistics of your household, who you're feeding, what the age group is.
you are expected to hit an income level, but we don't ask you to bring us that information. It's on a honor system. So there really isn't a lot of barriers. I think the biggest barrier that I hear is transportation. And that's why, you know, thanks to Chief Collins and the police department, we were able to move it downtown to try to help with that access.
So one other thing is that the farmers markets that I know that we do are open to anyone, and the farms actually run them. So like the farmers will bring in their produce, and it's not, and anyone can purchase. The other thing I would add is that there are opportunities to be able to use, if you, you know, what we used to call food stamps and public assistance in terms of money at those farmers markets to purchase the goods. And there's some policies that folks have done across the country to encourage people to use those funds, like doubling up, or one of the places now are doing these, you get a $2 bag of fruit and vegetables. And whatever's in the bag is what you get. So they just make these bags, they, you know, try to make them equal, and anybody who can come can pay $2 for just a big bag of vegetables and fruit. What they found was getting people who have never tried, you know, Jerusalem artichoke to purchase Jerusalem artichoke wasn't gonna happen. But if it came in my $2 bag, I took it home and I figured something out. And one of the farmers markets also started putting in recipes for what to do with those. So that was a really fun part also, to get folks to go, okay, now what is that? It looks like a misshapen potato. What do I do with that? Maybe I'll cook it like a potato. That works, not the truth. We're gonna close up on time. I wanna thank you all for your great ideas. Ask you to give yourselves a round of applause. Before I pass this to Tom, I want to just leave you with two things. One is health and equity in our policy starts with the idea that we should be encouraging the health outcomes to be the best they can be for everyone, and that the policy should be win-win. So if you can do that, you're 90% of the way there. Secondly, ensuring that these things are durable changes. Think about policies that create multiple solutions and not just programs that solve individual problems. Thank you so much. I'm going to pass it on.
And I do want to thank all of you, but I also want to thank Mo, and let's give him this isn't a one-off. This isn't one of those things that you do, and then you go home and you forget about it. This is one of those things that should really plant a seed for that next step. I do have some ideas for what that next step might be. I've talked to the mayor about how receptive he thinks that the city government may be in terms of the role that the community might play in advising, weighing in, asking questions about policies that are either being in the evolutionary phase or being de-evolution, coming back off of the books. What I'd like to do is to follow up with all of you via email, because I know all of your email addresses, because you've at least gotten five or six in the last month. But I will be following up to see what your interest may be. We'll keep it simple. We'll take small steps. We'll identify a couple of topics. Try to find out who might be interested in being available when the city is looking, or the county commissioners are looking at that policy, so that we can weigh in. And the way I phrased it to him is not to say, do this, do that, but to say, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? Because this is gonna be an introduction to building a relationship with those folks that create policies. It can't just be going and break down the door. Now, anybody who does that on their own and has that individual voice, I'm all for that. I've broken down some doors myself. But this is about creating that partnership with those folks that create policy and being able to make sure that your voices can be heard. So when I reach out, please respond. So again, thank you very much. I've been here almost 3 years in Marion as the health commissioner. And I got to tell you, today is the highlight of that 3 years. The fact that we've got the community participation across the sectors that we've got, this is public health. And so this, for me, this is pretty cool. So I want to thank you all. Thank you.
Butterworth. I am Director of Development for Marion General Hospital Foundation. I was very pleased to be invited to the conference today. It's been a good workshop because I think all of us from different walks of life, different organizations within the community are learning about partnerships and how we all have resources we can share and that we can work together to create really a healthier community in Marion so that we can help one another. We've all identified different resources that we have, advantages that we have, that if we all partner together and share these resources, we will become a better, healthier community.
I'm Dave Claiborne, Community Relations and Development Director here at Ohio State Marion, and it's a real pleasure to have all of these people from the community here to talk about health and our community and the what happens to our community. And I think that's a way that Ohio State can be used as a catalyst to bring folks like this together, to bring solutions to our community. And you know, Gordon Gee, our former president, always said Ohio State's mission is to solve society's big problems. Well, that's, I think, what we're all about here, and I hope that this is successful.
My name's Lois Hall. I'm the Executive Director of the Ohio Public Health Association, and I am absolutely very excited to be here today. To my knowledge, this is the first event like this that has happened anywhere in Ohio, and for a local health department to have convened a group like this, a large group, 80, 90 people from a variety of perspectives in the community, shows to me a great deal of leadership on the part of the health department, but also a great deal of caring and compassion among the community, and a desire to make it better, to make Marion great again. And so it's a great day with good conversation, people looking at real problems and real situations and trying to figure out where is the health and where is the equity in the response to those situations. So it's been a great day. I really appreciated the invitation and sitting together with the folks at my table to talk about some of the things that are happening here in Marion.
Hi, I'm Beth Babbage with the League of Women Voters, and we're very glad to be here today. League was founded over almost 100 years ago, and our idea was to promote social equity for all people, like giving women the vote. Since then, we've been active in promoting policies that promote academic, social, and health equity for all people.
Hello, my name is Teresa Lepke. I'm the Executive Director with the Marion Family YMCA. And the YMCA is involved in our conversation today because we know that it's important to look at our community in terms of equity and to develop policies and systems and create an environment where everyone has equal and equitable opportunity to be physically active and have access to healthy foods.
Hi, my name is Tara Dyer, and I am a member of the Marion Public Board of Health. And I'm excited to be a part of this very worthwhile event today that discusses the inequities that we experience in our health care. It's very informative. A lot of different people have come to the table to try to find solutions for our little town of Marion. So hopefully we will leave today with a plan of action. So grateful and fortunate to be here today. Thank you.
My name's Willie King, and I'm here with the Marion Minority Commission of Marion, Ohio. The program today is very interesting. I really enjoyed this. They talk about the opportunities for education, job training, how to move forward in Marion, Ohio. We need these programs. We need more of these programs. But we need the young people to come out and enjoy some of these programs too. Is there any more I need to go through? It's really nice. It's really nice. Hopefully we can get to do this again, and hopefully everything will get better as we move forward in Marion. Thank you. Have a great day.
Hi, I'm Mayor Scott Schertzer, and I'm at the Health and Policy meeting today here at OSUM. And I have to tell you that it's brought more attention to some of the issues in our community than I ever thought it would. I'm really grateful that so many community leaders and policymakers came together in one place to discuss this issue, and I hope the things that we have talked about here today can come to fruition in the future and start to make real and meaningful changes and recommendations to those of us that actually have the responsibility of making policies for our community.
My name is Gary Barber. I'm the superintendent of the Marion City School, and it's great to be here today along with a lot of our civic and community leaders to talk about some of the issues that we face in the Marion community. I think the most powerful thing is that we're taking a look at some of the policies that directly affect our community and hopefully coming up with some possible solutions to help our community continue to grow and prosper.
Hello, my name is Ayers Ratliff from the City Council here in Marion. I do want to thank you for watching today. I want to thank you for your willingness, for your participation, and for your interest in public safety. As we address our issues here in Marion, Ohio, I encourage you not only to help here, but to help in your community to make your community, as well as we're trying to make Marion a better place to live.
Hi, I'm Tom Quaid, I'm Marion County Health Commissioner. I was so pleased at the event today that we had such great participation from across so many different sectors of our community. When we planned this, we had anticipated about 40 people. We ended up with more than twice that, and it's been a very lively discussion, and I'm sure that we've got next steps already lined up. So I just wanted to recognize Marion County for taking this very progressive step forward.